Our next speaker is Marcella Martin. She is a PhD student in the Department of Italian Studies at NYU. She holds a master's degree in visual culture, customs studies from New York University, and was an intern in the Custom Institute at the Met during her studies. Ms. Martin was a curator of the Textile and Custom Collection at Philadelphia University and served as the president of the Mid-Atlantic region of the Custom Society of America. Her research interests include history of costume and textile in Italy and in Italian literature. Her talk today is called Made in Italy, Fashion and the Italian Americans.
Thank you very much for that introduction. Thank you to everyone for being here, and thank you for the opportunity to present this research. The last decades of the 20th century were a pivotal time for the Italian American community. As has been well documented, it was during this period that Italian Americans advanced both economically and socially. It was also during this time that Italian-made goods, and luxury fashion in particular, gained ever greater cachet among American consumers. The availability of made-in-Italy products, combined with the newfound purchasing power, created an unprecedented opportunity for Italian Americans to experience their ethnicity in a way that was not simply symbolic, but lived. This paper builds on the existing research through an analysis of the establishment of Made in Italy as a marketing schema in the post-war period and the Italian-American magazine Attenzione, which was published between 1979 and 1986. Together, these sources show that the availability of Made in Italy luxury fashion during the last decades of the 20th century were integral to shifting perceptions of the Italian-American community. Although the field of Italian fashion was active from the earliest decades of the 20th century, the 1950s are often credited with establishing the industry in the global marketplace. It was during this decade that a defining connection was drawn between the Renaissance and contemporary fashion design. The Italian industry needed to establish roots, both nationally in terms of a unified cultural identity in the post-war period, and internationally to compete with the French, who had enjoyed hegemony over international fashion design since the 18th century. They did so by recalling their own history of successful design and craftsmanship during the Renaissance. As Carlo Marco Belfani writes, quote, "The revival of the Renaissance and its invention as an intangible asset was fundamental in resolving this dual absence of cultural identity and international legitimization, and it therefore became a key factor in the international success of Italian fashion," end quote. The intangibility of the Renaissance would be key to the success of Made in Italy as a marketing tactic. It was utilized to invent continuity where in fact there was little from the Renaissance to the mid-20th century, and it was invoked to differentiate Italian fashion from its various competitors. American actresses were among the first international consumers to bring cachet to Italian fashion design in the post-war period, just as Italy was reestablishing itself as an important player in global economics. It was during this time that Italy experienced an economic miracle that was encouraged by new trade relationships within Europe, ending a period of protectionism. The emerging industries from engineering to petrochemicals paved the way for a new modern Italy located primarily in the north. The center and northeast, on the other hand, were labeled the Third Italy, and industries there flourished in traditional sectors like clothing, shoemaking, furniture production, ceramics, and leather goods. It was here that designers such as the Sorelle Fontana and Fernanda Gattinoni would begin a long-lasting and important relationship with American actresses like Elizabeth Taylor and Ava Gardner through their ties to Cinecittà in Rome, the capital of cinema and fashion in Italy during the post-war. Their designs helped to establish the idea of a fine Italian hand that became the hallmark of Made in Italy and would continue to inform the American conception of Italian fashion throughout the 20th century. Two important events marked the emergence of Italian fashion on the international scene. The first was actress Linda Christian's selection of the Sorelle Fontana to create her wedding dress when she married Tyrone Power in 1949. And the second was a fashion show organized by the Marchese Giovanni Battista Giorgini in his home, the Villa Torrigiani, in Florence on February 12, 1952. Giorgini believed that the time was right to invest in Italian fashion exports towards the United States, and he invited American buyers to attend the event, which showcased Italian design against the backdrop of Florentine grandeur. The event solidified an already growing association between Italy, luxury vacations, una specie di nuovo grand tour in the mind of American consumers, and Italian fashion. In the subsequent years, designers such as Gucci, Ferragamo, Pucci, and Roberta Di Camerino would continue to participate in Giorgini's fashion shows, now held in the Sala Bianca at the Medici Palace of Palazzo Pitti, further supporting the connection between exceptional Renaissance craftsmanship and Italian fashion. Giorgini was key in internationalizing the new narrative of Italian fashion design, as he, quote, understood how the combination between craft skills and an image as the home of good taste would be an intangible but winning asset for Italian fashion, end quote. The implications of establishing a successful industry were great, quote, fashion as a manufacturing industry and as a powerful symbolic force acted for both the Marshall Plan'd Europe, Italy and France in particular, and the United States as an economic and diplomatic rehabilitator, end quote. With its roots in the Renaissance and its ability to drive economic growth, fashion was integral to establishing the new face of Italy in the post-war period. The phrase made in Italy, as opposed to simply saying Italian fashion or alta moda in the French manner of French fashion or haute couture, most likely grew out of advertising campaigns supported by the Italian Trade Commission in the 1970s that utilized earlier associations between the Renaissance and Italian craftsmanship in the promotion of Italian goods. Over the course of the 1960s and 70s, the Italian Trade Commission worked to place a variety of Italian products, from fashion to cars, in foreign markets, especially the United States. The American market was key for Italian exports, as there was already a large Italian population in search of and willing to purchase Italian products. The first items to succeed in the American market were foodstuffs. For example, Barilla pasta began to be sold in the U.S. during the 1950s. They were quickly followed by cars, clothing, and the earliest luxury goods. The Italian Trade Commission was integral not only to establishing import-export relationships, but also in advising companies on the importance of print advertising and supporting manufacturers engaged in producing Made in Italy products through economic subsidies. Made in Italy as an official marketing campaign was inaugurated in 1980 to endorse a new image of Italian products abroad that emphasized craftsmanship and luxury. In the intervening years between the appearance of the first Italian goods on the American market and the official establishment of Made in Italy, Italian fashion experienced unprecedented growth. During the 1970s, Italy distinguished itself in the fashion industry through numerous luxury, ready-to-wear design houses that would become international brands before the close of the 20th century. Among the most recognized at the time were Giorgio Armani and Gianni Versace, but others, including Missoni and Gucci, were establishing their aesthetic and consumer base in this period as well. With their designs, these houses promoted a vision of Italian fashion that was based in traditional craft ideals long associated with Italy and the Renaissance, such as tailoring and fine workmanship, while also encouraging a perception of the Italian lifestyle that appealed to Italian immigrants in the United States and Americans alike. It was during this time, as Italian products gained ever greater momentum in the U.S., that the first magazine focused entirely on Italian-American culture emerged. Attenzione magazine embraced a more affluent readership and advertised high-end consumer goods that transcended prescribed notions of Italian ethnicity. It was particularly successful in targeting those second or third generation Italian-Americans who had achieved unprecedented purchasing power in the 1980s. According to a New York Times article dated January 29, 1981, on Attenzione's expansion, quote, a subscriber study by Dom Bodrin Associates found the audience an equal mixture of men and women around 51 years of age who tended to be professional managerial and lived in households with an average income of $37,300. Adjusted for inflation, this amount would be a six-figure salary in 2019. Attenzione's target audience reflected the changes that had already begun to manifest in the Italian-American community throughout the 1970s, when second-generation Italian-Americans in the greater New York City area specifically had begun to leave the city's Little Italies for the suburbs. As Kathleen Niels-Konzen explains in The Invention of Ethnicity, A Perspective from the USA, this group in particular, quote, sought to cash in on the cachet of contemporary Italian design and style by consuming Gucci, Pucci, Ferrari, etc. From its inaugural July 1979 issue onward, Attenzione featured a variety of lifestyle material from interviews with Italian-American actors like Sylvester Stallone and John Travolta to discussion pieces on schooling, values, and traditions. Throughout these articles, the underlying themes were the Italian-American experience and the establishment of an ongoing connection with news, events, and culture in Italy. For example, the magazine featured a regular column entitled Insight. In February 1983, the article considered the experience of Italian-American women who sought to maintain family traditions in the changing landscape of the American workforce. Another regular column entitled L'Italia Oggi wrote about gli italiani e la moda in November-December 1986. This article was printed in both Italian and English and began by asserting, when it comes to clothes, the term Italian is considered a special label everywhere, a seal of unquestioned quality, and the place of honor within the Made in Italy category is naturally occupied by our famous fashion designers. Fashion, although just one of many topics in the magazine, like its positioning in the Made in Italy marketing schema, held a place of honor in Attenzione as well. Among its strengths in the promotion of Italian fashion was that Attenzione looked at the industry as a cohesive national product, featuring biographies and interviews with Italian designers and seasonal editorials that emphasized the values of Made in Italy. For example, although Armani was often seen as the primary arbiter of Northern Italian refinement and elegance, represented by neutral wool menswear, an editorial from June 1982 reads, quote, "In bold defiance of the gray of winter, Giorgio Armani has orchestrated his latest collection to bring back a hint of spring, all comprised of marvelous, easy-to-wear fabrics and spectacular splashes of color," end quote. Just over 6 months earlier, the magazine featured an editorial on Gianni Versace's latest collection that was a far cry from Maria Laurino's description of his designs that, quote, "internalized the taste of the poor, drawing on the influences of Southern Italy," end quote. The magazine described Versace's designs as practical, while Versace himself said of his work, quote, "I am the Italian designer that sends our own Italian traditions abroad. This autumn's collection was inspired by the Italian Renaissance," end quote. These examples show the image of Italian fashion that was advertised to Italian Americans in the 1980s. Designers that were continuously innovating to position themselves in Italian style at the forefront of design. Furthermore, it offered Italian Americans a product that transcended regional differences and united the community as a whole. The power of Made in Italy products for the Italian American buyer was that it offered this group the opportunity to participate in American consumerism through specifically Italian products. An article in the December 1979 issue of Attenzione gives a brief overview of the history of Italian designs in American retail stores. By this point, Americans had become familiar with the Italian style, and quote, "The American retailer, always hot on the trail, took heed. The trendy boutiques were the first foothold of the new Italian menswear, but the Italians themselves quickly saw the potential market among America's big city shoppers, and Italian-owned boutiques with Italian-made goods began to spring up," end quote. Shops owned by Italian Americans would become especially important points of retail for first-generation Italians who had become accustomed to tailored clothing in Italy. In general, quote, "The more the customers bought and the more the press spread the word, the more Italian names the average shopper began to recognize, all signs that the Italian influence was here to stay," end quote. This influence would be the impetus for the first Moda Boutique in New York's Saks Fifth Avenue, a more than 5,000 square foot area dedicated to Italian menswear labels, from the well-known Armani brand to smaller design houses such as Alberto Allegri. It also corresponded with the growth or expansion of various Italian brands, including Ferragamo, as seen in the previous timeline. The endorsement of Made in Italy goods throughout American culture dramatically altered Italian Americans' experience of assimilation. Rather than an expression of ethnicity that existed on the margins of society, Made in Italy products, and particularly the Americans' embrace of Italian fashion, created a new sense of ethnic pride within the Italian American community. Furthermore, while Italian American consumption of Italian fashion mirrored mainstream middle class values in ways that would seem to support total assimilation, the fact that these products were manufactured in Italy bolstered relationships with the homeland. Made in Italy allowed for a new Italian American identity, one that did away with the three-part schema devised by Alfred Aversa in his article Italian Neo-Ethnicity, The Search for Self-Identity, or the manifestations envisioned by Herbert J. Gans as simply symbolic. The schema devised by Aversa included a focus on Renaissance grandeur, typically adopted by Italian-American organizations, such as the National Italian-American Foundation, to redirect conceptions about the group towards their illustrious past in Italy, rather than the tough living conditions that characterized their early years in the U.S. The second was an embrace of the traditions of one's immigrant parents or grandparents and was said to be highly fashionable. This motif was called contadino or pastoralism and appeared to be presented with the American tourist in mind through advertisements such as those by, quote, Alitalia Airlines, which offers the Italy of your grandparents, end quote. Finally, the third motif was the immigrant experience with its emphasis on hard work and family. These elements, first outlined by Aversa in 1978, guided subsequent authors in their discussion of Italian ethnicity. How these conceptions of ethnicity were manifested was debated by academics writing in the late 1970s and 1980s. Herbert J. Gans proposed what he called symbolic ethnicity, the adoption of new forms of ethnic behavior and affiliation that could be performed or discarded at will. This line of thinking also informed Gans's later writing, in particular a 2014 article entitled The End of Late Generation European Ethnicity in America, where he argues, quote, some, perhaps only a small proportion, will maintain a sporadic or occasional identity. The expression of that identity will usually be only of momentary length, and also will probably be a terminal one, end quote. Gans's position was closely related to the three-part schema established by Aversa and the manifestations of ethnicity contained therein. Participation in Italian-American organizations, travel, and celebrations of the immigrant experience. In a similar vein, a study of Italian-Americans conducted by psychologist Dr. Eileen Riotto-Siri in 1985 analyzed the rapid movement of this group into the American mainstream in the 1980s, taking into account changes in education, incomes, and geographical relocation. These changes were said to be the cause of an identity crisis among third-generation Italian Americans due to the alienation they felt from their families. However, these authors failed to account for the power of consumerism among Italian Americans and the rise of Made in Italy within the American market. As consumption grew among Italian Americans, its potential to bridge gaps between children and their parents also became more evident. In her essay on invoking ethnicity in the buying and selling of Guido, Danielle Battisti writes that, quote, ethnic family strategies suggest that consumption is not just driven by the acquisition of mainstream status symbols, but in the service of traditional family values, end quote. Consumption, therefore, had the power to bring Italian ethnicity and its roots in a strong sense of family cohesion up to speed with Italian Americans' new reality in the middle class. Furthermore, the possibility to share Italian ethnicity through Made in Italy products enabled parents who had gained a newfound appreciation for their homeland in the 1970s and 1980s to transmit this sentiment to their children, reviving or reinventing Italian ethnicity for a further generation. Italian luxury fashion, from small leather goods to suits, was the foundation upon which this reinvention of ethnicity would be possible. How was it that Italian Americans' experience of assimilation in the latter half of the 20th century, through education and occupation, did not require immigrants and their children to forget they were Italian? As Courtney Ritter explains, quote, throughout the 1980s, 1990s, and today, the Made in Italy label provides a means of assimilation and gave validity to affluent Italian Americans who could now unproblematically express a connection to Italian culture, end quote. It opened the door for brands like Barilla Pasta later in the 1990s to capitalize on these associations that had been established between Italians, Made in Italy, and fashionability in their ad campaigns. I'm almost done. Quote, Barilla was not trying to melt into American society through emulation, but to seduce middle-class Americans with the supposed Italian values of elegance and high quality, and to become an ambassador of this new authentic Italian identity, end quote. It was an Italian identity that now anyone could and would be proud to adopt and embody. This paper has attempted to outline the various factors that enabled the Italian-American community to embrace their ethnicity in the late 20th century. In particular, it has argued that the visibility and availability of Made in Italy products across the American market was integral in reflecting this important shift in the Italian-American community. This shift encompassed economic progress that typically alienated immigrant groups from their ethnicity. Rather, the consumption of Made in Italy goods, and luxury fashion especially, celebrated both economic success and ethnic pride. Fashion allowed the Italian-American consumer to literally put on their ethnicity, emphatically transcending previously conceived notions of ethnicity as simply symbolic. Furthermore, it generated a sense of pride in Italian culture and craftsmanship due to its success in American magazines, boutiques, and department stores. What started out as primarily an economic endeavor on the part of the Italian Trade Commission had become, for both Italian Americans and Americans more broadly, the embodiment of high fashion, quality, and appropriateness by the end of the 20th century.
This new kind of ability to be proud of Italian heritage as a result of these, you know, the Made in Italy label and all that, I wonder if the identification with a particular part of Italy has become like appiattito, like flattened out, because I'm thinking about how the difference, for example, between Giorgio Armani, who reflects a very northern aesthetic, and Gianni Versace, who reflected a very southern aesthetic. And so I'm wondering if, you know, Italians, you know, most of the Italian Americans in this country came from the South, not all, but most. So it's interesting to think that regardless of where you came from in Italy and what your life was like, or your grandparents' life or your parents' life, now you can identify with any Italian, or your identification is with something Italian, but the regional aspect seems to be left out to a certain degree. Would you agree with that?
I would agree, and I think that it has to do with the origins of Made in Italy as a marketing schema in the Renaissance. So by claiming a Renaissance ancestry, it does flatten, as you said, to use your word, this idea, that campanilismo, that is, you know, very prevalent in earlier manifestations of Italian-American ethnicity. I think nowadays it's very different, and I think that, well, you know, there are still pockets, but I think to a certain extent, when it comes to participating in Made in Italy, that because Made in Italy is an Italian product, it's not really seen as, and that was one of the things I was attempting to show in the images of Armani and Versace, that these designers did not think of themselves as North-South. They thought of themselves as Italian designers. And I think that comes across in the products as well.
I'm just curious to know if Italian fashions are still made in Italy, or are they outsourced to the third world?
Yeah, I mean, that's a very contemporary issue that we have. So on the one hand, you have a huge Chinese community in Italy. So you have the Chinese community in Prato, for example, where they're actually running the factories that are producing Made in Italy. So it raises the question of, is this still made in Italy if it's essentially made by, you know, a Chinese factory that has been transported into Italy. The way that most Italian companies get around the Made in Italy label nowadays is that they assemble parts in Italy, so the parts are manufactured in China or elsewhere, and then in order to actually still be able to stamp it Made in Italy, they assemble those various pieces within Italy. So yeah, it's the reality of the modern market.
Our last speaker is David Aliano. He's an associate professor of Italian and history and chair of the Department of Modern Languages and Literatures of College of Mount St. Vincent. He's also the associate editor of the Ethnic Studies Review. His areas of research include modern Italy and Latin America, Italian transnational and comparative studies, national and ethnic identity, and Italian fascism and anti-fascism. He is the author of Mussolini's National Project in Argentina and has published widely on Italian immigration and travel, the Italian vote abroad, and colonial culture. His paper today is entitled Conflicted Gazes, Visual Depictions of Italy for the American Tourist Market.
This paper looks comparatively at the changing self-projected images of Italy and Italians produced by the Italian State Tourist Bureau, ENIT, and marketed to American tourists from the fascist period through post-war reconstruction, and contrast them with the visual and literary images found in popular American travel writing. Part of a larger ongoing project that explores the reshaping of Italian identity from abroad through American travel encounters with Italy in the 20th century, this paper focuses on what the Italian government showed Americans and what Americans saw, its dissonances and its convergences, its changes and continuities throughout this period. Purposefully disrupting traditional periodizations, the period I examine runs from fascism through Reconstruction, 1922 to 1953, a period of tumultuous social political change in Italy that also coincided with the steady rise of popular American tourism as Italy emerged as the premier American tourist destination. For many Americans, tourism was the primary point of contact with Italy's social, cultural, and political realities. The visual images and textual depictions contained within popular travel literature, therefore, provides the prism from which tourists interpreted those realities. Adopting a transnational perspective, this paper highlights the dynamic interplay between the two competing images of Italy in direct dialogue with one another, which together shaped and reshaped Italian identity. So it was in the 1920s that American tourism really emerged as significant in Italy. After 1925, they surpassed the British as the largest English-speaking tourist population in Italy. And by 1929, with over 200,000 visitors, American travelers became the second largest tourist group in Italy, representing 16.5% of all tourists in Italy. So the American presence already was increasingly large and influential, and therefore the target of the ENIT and Italian tourist propagandists. This coincided with the period of Mussolini's fascist regime. As we heard in a previous talk, Mussolini's regime propagandized itself near and far, at home and abroad, widely through various forms of media. And travel literature and propaganda was not an exception. During this period, Italy modernized and centralized its tourist bureaucracy. The ENIT, which had been founded in 1919, became more governmentally controlled and centralized, and an offshoot of that was formed in 1929, the CIT, which handled more of the logistics of tourism during this period. The magazine I'm going to focus especially on for a lot of the images for the Italian projections of its self-image towards American tourists are from Travel in Italy, which was the official magazine of the Italian Tourist Bureau. With a circulation of over 50,000 and published in four language editions, the magazine was particularly influential. The Inn had published a lot of guidebooks and hotel guides and guides towards monuments and history and attractions. This magazine did not do any of that. Instead, it focused on contemporary Italian life, travel news, and particularly Italy's image and the Italian lifestyle for the tourist market. And you can see by the vibrant color art and the photographs I'll show, the image that the fascist Italian regime projected of Italy. It was an Italy of alpine sports. And throughout these images, you see very attractive, usually blonde and blue-haired models enjoying various leisurely activities from skiing in the Alps to seaside resorts and spas. And often you would see very sophisticated-looking Italians of an affluent class enjoying various sports and physical activities in particular, and various high-class leisurely pursuits. It was also in Italy of the latest Italian fashions as well, and they tried to showcase already in the 1930s a particular Italian look in their material. They were in direct conversation with many of their perceived stereotypes that foreigners would have of Italy. In one such article, Mario Ramperti writes, "Where once the young shepherd shod in colce played his reed pipe while tending his flocks, surrounded by the picturesque ruins of the Appian Way, where the gondolier spent his time serenading his blonde inamorata, lying in the sun heedless of the flies on a deserted landing stage. One sees instead today stadi and docks, electric plants, bridges, express trains, the new generation under the energetic and inspiring fascist regime that has now changed the aspect of life in the country. The terre des morts is now indeed the land of the living as new blood throughs the country's youth." And you see images of that. And there really is an unusual amount of this material project, projections of aqueducts, dams, bridges, and the autostrada, which one article marveled that were bold in their conception and their planning and represented, quote, the vanguard of Italian progress. This progress was inextricably linked in the material to fascism. And as much of the propaganda elsewhere projected, Italian identity was connected, modern Italian identity, with fascism and the new Italy. So we see a lot of the same images you would find in other propaganda, also finding its way in this travel magazine somewhat incongruously. So too, Benito Mussolini, of course, figures prominently. Here you see him as the leading sportsman of Italy. Italy's leading pilot as well, of course. And this one in the bottom was really in an odd place. It was about seaside resorts. And none other than Il Duce was taking a swim in that particular article. So although readers would still have found some of the familiar Italy of old, of quaint hill towns, ancient ruins, medieval churches, and Renaissance masterpieces, they are now presented with an alternative Italy, an Italy of the future, of youth, of sport, recreation, high society, an Italy of snow-capped chalets, health spas, baths, and an Italy racing towards the future of electric lines, factories, rationalist architecture, superhighways, and airplanes. In short, an Italy of progress and modernity, a young Italy rejuvenated by fascism. We know that the Italian travel writers, whose images I will now show you, read the Italian tourist propaganda because they tell us so. Many of them raved about all the various guides and materials, and especially the discount coupons that were provided by the CIT and the ENIT as they marketed Italy. As one American travel writer remarked, she wishes, one can sense at every turn, to exhibit what she has done and what she is doing. Official Italy is anxious to dissipate old impressions and create new ones. And this is, she is certainly accomplishing. You find in a lot of the material acknowledgement of everything the fascists wanted the American traveler to see. Many do make mention of the reconstruction, one marveling at, quote, the old roads resurfaced and new highways rebuilt. Others do make mention of the power plants and machinery. As one travel writer wrote, the new government is working hard to revive the old glories of ancient Rome with new railways and factories and power plants. However, as one writer, Clara Lofton, advised her American readers, if you are bent upon picturesque squalor and will hurry, you may yet still see some in Italy. You'll notice that there weren't any images in the Italian tourist material of those factories or power plants or modernity. Instead, Italian travelers were looking for, and the guides were producing, images of a timeless, romantic, picturesque Italy. Charles S. Brooks, who wrote his own personal travel narrative, A Winter in Italy, wrote of his wife, who saw such picturesque images as a source of artistic inspiration. Quote, Mary tried her hand at sketching. Her model for several mornings was a little boy who came from a native house of chickens and a goat. The lad's dirty face and rags were perfect in their way. Hubbard Hutchinson similarly filled his account with colorful descriptions of ageless Italian archetypes, unchanged by the winds of history. A, quote, young and dark Italian peasant moving an ox cart with an unhurried gaze, and an elderly peasant woman who, in one corner of her mouth, humorously folded over her long toothless gums a short black pipe. Throughout Hutchinson's narrative, Italians were darker and mysterious. For example, the people of Cortona he described as watching us shyly with dark commenting eyes. These were not the cheerful blonde and blue-eyed models found in travel in Italy, but really harkened back to a 19th century, almost realist image of Italy from around the turn of the century. And I think we get a great illustration of that and some of that dissonance in a very popular children's book from the 1930s, Robin and Jean Go To. In this case, Robin and Jean Go To Italy. The protagonists are the boy and the girl that you see in the top photo. Throughout the guide, the father does rave about all the modern accomplishments of Mussolini's regime. However, Sue Runyon's drawings found throughout of that harken back to a different Italy, more of Italy reminiscent of the turn of the century, of mustachioed Italians in bowler hats, of peasants in their traditional headdresses, carrying water bottles upon their heads. You can really see that contrast by the way Robin and Jean are smartly dressed in 1930s style outfits, contrasting with the Italians that they're interacting with in these images. So, excuse me. So in spite of praising Mussolini's regime and its modernity in the text, which they do, the visual images actually confirm and reinforce romanticized images of a picturesque and primitive Italy of old, the Italy that tourists were looking to see as an escape from the modern world that they had just left for their travels. During and after the war, the American presence in Italy would become widespread and far-reaching. The United States military occupation opened the post-war period and was soon followed by the Truman administration's substantial Marshall Plan investment in Italy's recovery and private United States and Italian business collaborations. Americans began returning to Italy as well, first among them soldiers, diplomats, investors, soon followed by artists, students, filmmakers, and celebrities, and pilgrims for the 1950 Catholic Jubilee. It would, however, ultimately be through tourism that most Americans would come into contact with the new Italy of the post-war. And you see here, the heir to travel in Italy of the Ennett publications was Italy's Life. And on its inaugural issue right after the Second World War, who is on the cover but none other than Mark Clark, the commander of the American Fifth Army, which occupied Italy at the end of the war and during the immediate post-war years. As you can tell by the images here, in the first few years of its existence, the priority was not so much on attracting tourists as on the post-war reconstruction and attracting support from America in particular, establishing business relations, and encouraging cultural and business collaborations between Italy and America. in these first years of its existence, articles emphasized a particular post-war narrative of the Italian government, one that wanted to look past Italy's recent past of fascism and to talk more about Italy's future and its ability to partner with the United States and reconstruct the nation and progress. Of the war itself, the narrative was one of shared sacrifice, collaboration of Americans and Italians to liberate Italy from an oppressive Nazi fascist occupation. So the shared sacrifice and brotherhood of the war is what's emphasized, as well as looking to the future, not to the past. We see an interesting parallel with the fascist propaganda that I showed you before the war. There is, again, an unusual obsession with showing material progress, and in this case, it's the reconstruction progress. So everything from Italy's textile industry to agricultural innovation and the, quote, today and tomorrow in Italy's electric industry. Especially by 1949, as things are returning to normalcy and the Enid is once again beginning to, and the cheat, to reestablish the tourist infrastructure in Italy, you have a return to familiar pre-war themes. Italy once again becomes the chic, modern, fashionable country, the fashionable destination that we saw in the fascist material. You have, once again, a return to the theme of fashion, of health spas, and of ski resorts, without, of course, any of the fascist propaganda Mussolini around. Travel was also being changed as well during this period. By 1949, all of the rail lines devastated by the war were once again working. The steamship service was operating as well, including the construction of the ill-fated Andrea Doria in 1953. Two major Italian airlines were founded. Ultimately, Alitalia would be the one that would predominate. And there was a new bus service and new bus itineraries, which really revolutionized the travel experience of traveling through the outdoor strada by road as mass tourism began to predominate in the post-war years. These services explicitly and expressly promoted themselves towards Americans, as you can see by this ad, which is directed solely towards American tourists and the special services they could provide for them. The first American tourists in Italy were American GIs. And the very first guidebook that I found of Italy dates to 1944, actually, A Soldier's Guide to Rome, which was distributed for American GIs stationed in Rome during the war and the immediate occupation. It's many really interesting points capture a moment in time in which you learn of what are approved destinations for US servicemen and many, many cautions about what servicemen need to avoid, to beware of the black market, to beware of local vendors exploiting Italian GIs, and one of my favorites, to watch out imbibing hard liquors, which, quote, just isn't Italy's long suit. These restrictions were highly suggestive of activities GIs probably did engage in. Horace Sutton, in his Footloose in Italy in 1954, filled in colorful detail anecdotes of the GI experience and many of their misadventures in Italy during this period. He noted the remnants of these experiences well after the American occupation. Quote, 4 years after the war and 2 years after the occupation, it is surprising to hear the prostitutes sitting at the cafes open the bidding with the familiar, hey Joe, got a cigarette? Wartime memories, which the Italian tourist propaganda would like to have forgotten and to move on looking at Italy's democratic future, were a topic in the early travel literature of American tourists. They like to focus especially on the wartime destruction, on the American cemeteries throughout Italy as a new part of the itinerary for American travelers, and battlegrounds, as you can see, Anzio's battleground here. And there's a wonderful line in Horace Sutton's guide where a traveler asks, is anyone famous buried here, talking of the cemetery Nettuno? And the caretaker saying, mister, as far as I'm concerned, they're all famous, talking about the GIs buried there. Interestingly, there's far more images of fascism in the post-war American travel guides than there were in the pre-war guides, although the fascist propagandists might not have liked how they depicted some of these. Eleanor Clark, for example, in talking about the Foro Mussolini, which if you can still see it as a Foro Italica, has a lot of these fascist slogans everywhere. And she wrote that some of these slogans are just offhand bits of fact dropped in among the illustrations, as if the workman's brain had been so stuffed with them, they felt uncontrollably everywhere. It's like hearing a troubled person talking in his sleep. You would like to help him. Many of them were really surprised how Italians had seemed to have forgotten this recent past and moved on, and many were somewhat nostalgic for that period and what was left of it. Similarly, while they talk about the material progress, there is again a recurring image of the picturesque and timeless Italy. Just to show you one or two quotes, and then I'll go to my conclusion. Horace Sutton writes, and these are his photographs that I'm showing you. Quote, there is none of the frenzied American stress for continual improvement. One senses that the country would like to go back to where it was before the shooting started, but not necessarily farther. The shops and offices open till 9 and noon again from 4 to 8. Between times, Italians talk politics, dawdle over an aperitif, eat, sleep, and propagate. A lot of his stereotypical images of a backward Italy focus on the South and on Southern Italians, and he wrote, it's in the South where, quote, the peasants have the hot country character. They carry baskets on their head, wear no shoes on their feet. They are poor and they are many, and they crowd the streets and choke the highways. They are also dark and look pretty much like anyone might have expected of Italy before taking a trip there. For Sutton, it's Southern Italy where Americans find their expectations met for the picturesque, impoverished, and somewhat dangerous. But Italy was changing in the American image, and we see that in these slides, which really tie in well with the Made in Italy talk we just heard. The high society of Italy in the 1950s, as the American presence was becoming strongly felt, as more and more American celebrities and filmmakers made their way to Rome, as well as artists and scholars. Here we have a picture of Ferragamo in Florence with Garbo, Rossellini and Bergman, and the celebrity life of the rich and famous. Anticipating Fellini's La Dolce Vita by a decade, one writer remarked, the playboys and playgirls with their latest husbands and wives flock Rome in ever-increasing numbers. They crowd the sidewalk tables along the Via Veneto, staring at one another and in turn being stared at and photographed. It's really in the 1950s that we see the beginning of the branding of Italy as made in Italy and the beginning of a convergence of the Italian projections of its new image as chic, modern, and fashionable, meeting those American expectations. And I'll end here with this slide, in particular of the Roman holiday, which really marks that turning point, the end of the Reconstruction era and the beginning of the economic miracle and the new forms of branding of Italy and what really we come to know of as the tourist Italy today that we see. Thank you very much.
So even today, a lot of people think of Florence, Rome, Venezia, Milano as the sort of like the top places to go. You touched on this a little bit in the end, but was a lot of this propaganda or a lot of this sort of tourism that the Italian government was marketing mainly still based on the North and the South was seen as like the rustic, more adventurous place to go.
Right. And I think you're absolutely right. There seems to be almost a Nordic image of Italy in the fascist period in a lot of the images that I showed you, and an emphasis on the North and on affluence. And as I mentioned, it's interesting that the writers did say, if you want picturesque Italy, they recommend Taormina, going to the South, Naples and South, if that's what you're looking for. So already you do start to see that contrast, I think, definitely.
Yeah, do you have any data on actual Italian Americans going to Italy or Sicily or Southern Italy after the war?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. Even before the war as well, I found a wonderful student narrative of a student trip to Italy during the fascist period in the 1930s, funded by the Italian government. And it was Peter San Martino's high school students from Jackson Heights, Queens, and many of them Italian American. So even in the 1930s, you see there's that connection. And you definitely see it in the post-war period as well, starting with the American GIs. So you do see that as one of the threads of the narrative in the post-war period. And a lot of Italian American charitable organizations reaching out to Italy, donating for Italian orphans, et cetera. So you definitely do see more of that in the 1940s, especially.
I was going to ask the same question about the Italian-American experience as, you know, post-war tourist block. It was also a time when Italian-Americans got to go on these new guided tours. And a lot of second, third generation Italian-Americans discovered in Italy they had never even seen before. And I know my aunt did a tour, and she went to Milan and Florence and didn't go to Sicily or Calabria.
And they
had their first taste of Italy as the rest of the world knew it via this post-war travel.
And I think that's an excellent point, which was touched on by Marcella's paper as well, that this Italian heritage tourism is actually identifying with a more general Italianness that is more aligned with central and northern Italy rather than many of the places where their ancestors did actually come from in the south. Mm-hmm.